Lutheran Church on the fifth Sunday of the Epiphany season. If you're watching worship from home today, you are welcome to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion when you see us receive it here in the sanctuary. Everyone here in the sanctuary has the option of staying in their seats when it is time to receive communion, or of coming up to the altar rail. If you're staying where you are, you need one of those little white paper bags that contains the bread and wine or bread and juice that you will receive. And if you're coming up to the rail, you need to remember to stop at one of these little tables and take the bread and wine or the bread and juice, which is clearly marked. I'm happy to report that at last week's annual meeting of the congregation, we approved a budget for this year's ministry. And we added Charlie Hahn to the ranks of the church council. Please keep the council in your prayers as we try to discern God's will for us in the coming year. We also approved the revised wording of the statement of welcome that identifies us as a reconciling in Christ congregation. We are a community that welcomes and advocates for all of God's children, actively works for racial equity and economic justice, and honors the full spectrum of gender, sexual orientation, gender identification, and expression. We invite and encourage all people to participate fully in the life and work of this congregation and of the whole Christian Church, without regard to race or ethnicity, gender, age, abilities, gender identity or expression, sexual orientation, or economic status. Every Wednesday at 9 a.m., people from this congregation gather for breakfast at the Copper Kitchen on Central Avenue at 56th Street South. We have an online Bible study that meets on Thursdays at 2. And this week, we begin looking at some of the short letters from the Apostle Paul that are found in the New Testament. Believe it or not, it's time to start ordering Easter lilies, and you have an order form there in the bulletin. I'm right, we're not getting the big white ones that drop the pollen everywhere. We're getting smaller lilies that are in different colors. Asiatic, is that right? Asiatic lilies. Or if you don't feel you can take responsibility for a living thing, you can also order a virtual lily. And you can read about that in the bulletin. Didn't know there were virtual lilies, did you? All of you who volunteered to serve on the board of directors for the food pantry ministry have your first meeting today. During fellowship time, the food pantry board is meeting, so grab your treats and then find Lynn, and she will lead you in the paths of righteousness. We don't pass an offering plate anymore, but there is one out in the narthex, the entrance area of the church, where you can put financial gifts. Whether you are here or at home, you can use a smartphone and our QR code to make a donation on our website. You can also mail a check to the church or stop by in person and make a contribution to our ministries. The altar flowers are donated by Mike and Nina. I guess they sent their flowers instead of their presents. Well, thank you, Mike and Nina. This week, we're wishing a happy birthday to Ginny Trulio and to a new member of the family, Steve Stanley. Is Steve here? I'm not seeing Steve behind a mask. Is anybody in the sanctuary celebrating a birthday or an anniversary this week? Fine. Well, worship is an encounter with the divine, and I invite you now to take a moment of quiet in preparation for that encounter. As you're able to do so, and as it is easy to do so, I invite you to stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory. We have rejected your word when it made us affront ourselves. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us, that we may reflect your love for all creation. Rejoice in this good news. In Jesus, your sins are forgiven, and you are adopted into the household of Christ. Live as freed and forgiven children of God. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the world for that love of the church, for the unity of
Is because they see God already at work in the world. Today's psalm is the testimony of someone brought through a time of crisis by God's faithful love. Caught up in a fantastic vision of God's glory, a man named Isaiah becomes aware not only of his own sinful nature, but of the sinful culture in which he lives. A man named Paul is amazed that God would call him to be an apostle, despite his past persecution of the Christian church. A man named Peter is impressed by Jesus' teaching and miracles, but considers himself unworthy of God's attention. Let us pray. Most holy God, the earth is filled with your glory, and before you angels and saints stand in awe. Enlarge our vision to see your power at work in the world, and by your grace make us heralds of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from the prophet Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two, they covered their faces, and with two, they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the first letter to the Corinthians. Now I remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed unto you as of first importance, which I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all of the apostles. Lastly of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. Word of God, word of life.
Thank you, Peter God.
Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God. He saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. This story of a miraculous catch of fish is placed near the beginning of Luke's Gospel and almost at the very end of John's Gospel. I don't think it happened twice. I think the authors placed this event within their narrative in a way that supports their understanding of Jesus and of the mission of the church. This is Luke's version of the calling of Jesus' first disciples. But did you notice that Jesus didn't call them? There is no invitation to come, follow me. He just accepts it as a fact that these men will follow him. And he doesn't say that they'll spend their lives attempting to catch people. It's, "From now on, you will be catching people." In the Gospels of Matthew and Mark, The disciples drop everything and go when they are invited to follow Jesus. Luke must think that sounds a little unrealistic, so he provides some context, things that show why these men might have been so willing to follow. Jesus gets into Simon's boat because he has already met Simon in the previous chapter of the story. From his boat, Simon gets to hear some of the teaching of Jesus, and this is the second miracle that Simon witnesses. Like the prophet Isaiah, Simon feels profoundly unworthy when he realizes he is in the presence of God, and yet he responds to God's call. Luke takes all of these factors, an ongoing relationship with Jesus, the powerful teaching of Jesus, the power of God made evident in our lives, and he connects them to a shockingly abundant catch of fish. Now, the metaphor isn't perfect. I mean, fish are caught to be killed and served up for dinner. We are caught by God's word and by the testimony of God's people so that we can live our lives to the fullest. Luke's point is that the apostles won't win people to the Christian faith through their own efforts or through their personal magnetism. They will do it just by bearing witness to what they have seen and heard. This is also true for the prophet Isaiah. It is only because he experiences, in a very visceral way, the forgiveness of his own sins, that he isn't just willing to offer a message of God's forgiveness to his sinful people. He's eager to do it. He can't wait to do it. The author of Psalm 138 is compelled to testify to God's faithful love because they have experienced it in a time of crisis. This is what the Apostle Paul describes as passing on what has been received. For Paul, the thing of first importance isn't the teaching of Jesus or the miracles of Jesus, but the fact that Jesus died. This talk of the death and resurrection of Jesus is Paul's introduction of a new topic in a letter that tackles a whole bunch of topics. Next week, we're going to hear that some people in this Corinthian congregation are denying that we will be raised from the dead in exactly the same way that Jesus was. Paul is listing all of these witnesses to the resurrection in support of what we're going to hear next week. But for now, we have the Apostle Paul describing how he sees his place in the ranks of the apostles, dead last. When he calls himself one untimely born, he uses words that suggest a deformed, stillborn baby, a miscarriage, even an aborted fetus. That's how he sees himself. And yet, Jesus appeared to him, spoke to him, and gave him a mission and a purpose. Sometimes we think too little of ourselves. Sometimes we think too highly of ourselves. The Corinthians had been bragging about all of their blessings and all their spiritual gifts. Paul wants them to remember that God's attention is always on the lowly, on people like him who have nothing about which to brag. He tells the Corinthians that they have not yet arrived. They aren't saved in the past tense. They are in the process of being saved. and they will live out the rest of their lives in the process of being saved. Paul gives all the credit to God. Just as God raised Jesus from the dead, God is now transforming the Corinthian congregation. And God is saving us too. Each one of us is in the process of being saved by the personal attention of a merciful God, as all of us are molded into a community of faith that serves as the hands and the voice of Jesus. We are called to testify to what we have seen and heard. As we share in the body and blood of Christ, we too step over a threshold into the throne room of God. Our voices join in singing, "Holy, holy, holy," and we are transformed by this encounter. Isaiah learns that the all-powerful God cares about what is happening on earth. The psalmist is amazed that the Lord is high, yet cares for the lowly. There's wonder in the words, "When I called, you answered." Peter and Paul both feel completely unworthy of God's attention, but in gratitude for God's love, they take up the task to which they are assigned. They go out into the deep water of a culture that is at odds with the ways of God, and they let out the fishing nets of their unique witness to God's power and God's love. Each of us gets to do the same as we go about our ordinary day-to-day lives. None of us is called to be a superhero. We are just called to be faithful, to be persistent, maybe a little stubborn. Through us, through our hands and our voices, God's kingdom of justice and love can become our reality. Instead of thinking too much or too little of ourselves, each of us needs to say, "I am what I am, and God's grace toward me has not been in vain."
Now with you.
I invite you to confess using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Because the Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, we have boldness to pray for the church, for the world, and for all that God has made.
Equip us to share what we have first received, the love and the forgiveness shown to us through Jesus Christ. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Teach us to honor the natural world that shares your wonders. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Soften our hearts and those people in power to receive and attend to the needs of the lowly. Remove corruption and impulse toward violence. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your steadfast love endures forever. Never let go of those who look to you for hope and healing. Especially Bill Dyfel, Craig Bauer, Angie Akers, Shirley Carter, and all those we bring before you now. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
During Black History Month, teach us about all of our partners in the ministry of the church and of your work in society. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the word inspired to answer your call. Give us courage to live in and serve the kingdom to the day that you gather all of us into your glory. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all. Let's find ways to share signs of that peace with one another. If you're planning to stay in your seats for communion, you might want to open up that crinkly paper bag right now. And at the same time, I invite all of you to stand, if you're able to, and join in the offering prayer printed in the bulletin. Blessed are you, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table and prepare us to carry your love to a hungry world. In the name of Christ, amen.
The Lord be with you. And praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him as your beloved Son. And in the miracle of the water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one body by the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Welcome to God's table, where there is room enough for all. Amen. Please be seated. The ushers will tell you how and when to come forward for communion. If you are staying in your place, you can peel back the cover right now on the bread that you have. It is the body of Christ given for you. And then you can uncover the wine that you have. It is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you.
we give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to bring good news and to proclaim your favor to all, strengthened with the richness of your grace. In your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. As you're able to do so, I invite you to stand to receive God's blessing. May God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, and who calls you by name, bless all your journeys, today and forever. Amen. Thanks be to God.